العالمين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله لقد جاء رسول ربنا بالحق. سبحانك ربنا لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيد الأولين والآخرين وعالم السابقين وقائد قلب المحجلين سيدنا مولانا محمد اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأم الميامين وأصحابه نجوم الدين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما وفقهنا إذا علمتنا. اللهم انفعنا وانفعنا بالقرآن العظيم. اللهم اجعله لنا نورا وإماما وهدى ورحمة. اسمه كما تقول في البقرة عن آل عمران ليس برايز لا تقوى عند هيومن كان but out of the inner and anyone fix both of them is going to be perfect person. This is the outer. After that, we have Surah Nisa speak about you have one unit, speak about the community, or in another way, the social relation, your relation with the others. Here, it's going to expand much more to have your relation with the other. Inheritance, many matters of other things you know mentioned. The holy name, two holy names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were repeatedly mentioned in Surah Alim and Hakima. Alim and Hakima. And this just to tell us that here to have social relationship, we have knowledge and wisdom together, okay? And here, knowledge different than not wisdom. The wisdom will not show up everything you know. And that's why we mentioned about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that Allah Subh'anaHu Wa Ta-A'la mentioned, عَرَّفَ بَعْضَهُ وَأَعْرَضَ عَنْ بَعْضٍ. Okay? يعني, whatever has been manifested or uncovered, this is out of the knowledge. And whatever was being covered, has been covered, it is known. He was not ignorant there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is known, but the wisdom has been used to cover it, you know, and not uncover it. You see, yani, the wisdom is not going to uncover everything that you know of the other person or whatever. And personally, I highlight the inheritance law, which has been mentioned only in this surah, in details. And I don't look at it as only money-wise, you know, you are meant to inherit this amount of money or this piece of land or whatever from your relative. No, I look at it as a relation, yani how to deal with the others according to the percentage that mentioned in this surah. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, this is the first knowledge to be taken away or lift up from out my nation. Nowadays we have it available, and those who study fiqh, they look at it as the easiest one. So how come this is the first one to be lifted up? I think because of what's the hidden meaning, what's behind it to be looked at, really the one who guide himself, you know, according to the instructions mentioned there, to build his relation with the other relatives, he'll be really enlightened and guided very well. So basically, after fixing the oneself, this is, you may consider it as a fixation of the whole community, and by this you are going to have very valid community as Muslims. Any question about the first three surahs, you know, the first subgroup? There's no question, yes?
Sorry, when you said the first knowledge to be taken away, you gave the reasoning for it, I didn't get the reasoning.
Of which one will take away?
Oh, inheritance. The knowledge of inheritance.
Yeah, this is mentioned in the hadith that this is awwal 'ilmin yurfa. This is the first knowledge or the first science to be lifted up.
You said there's a hidden meaning behind it.
Yes, the hidden meaning, that means you are going to treat all those relatives, you know, according to the percentage which has been mentioned in this knowledge or in this science. Other questions? Okay, we'll move to the other group. And remind me at the end when we finish the whole groups, the whole first group of Sab'a al-Tiyar, to try to match them with the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I'm not going to speak, I spoke shortly about it yesterday. We'll try to match it with the Madani time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam before moving to another group. As you may remember, this was the Sab'a al-Tiyar. We put them in two subdivisions. The first subdivision has three surahs, the second subdivision has five surahs. They are Al-Ma'idah, Al-An'am, Al-A'raf, Al-Anfal, Al-Tawbah. The wording Al-Hukm is repeatedly mentioned in Surah Al-Ma'idah, rule or law or whatever of that regard. And that's why here we have the governmental and the international issues, you know, mentioned thoroughly in this surah. And that's why the quotation or the sentence, لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ الْأَرْضِ. Okay, the ruler is Allah. Why? Because لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ الْأَرْضِ. This quotation has been mentioned, I think, five times in this surah. And I should pay your attention that this may be used sometimes مَافِي elsewhere. مَافِي السَّمَاوَاتِ. Here, مُلْكُ. Why specifically mulk? Just to tell that this is the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and by this, for sure, the expectation, with the exception now of the kingdom of UK, you know, here, they don't rule, you know, the kings, they don't rule, you know, but generally speaking, the kings all over the place and all over the time and the history, they are the ruler, usually. And here, when you say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the king, that's mean he is the one who is authorized by himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, not by anyone else, to rule. And this, that's why you expect to have the hudud here, the punishment that mentioned, you know, many of them, not all of them, many of them, they were mentioned here in this particular surah. And why it was called Ma'idah? For sure, because the story of the Ma'idah with Sayyidina Isa and his companion was mentioned in this surah. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one hadith, that the two angels, when they came down to him, they gave an example about him and about his nation, like a master built a house and served food and sent an inviter. And whoever go with the inviter and reply to the inviter is going to enter the house, eat the food, and the master is pleased with him. Anyone who fail or refuse the invitation, he will not enter the house, he will not eat from the food, and the master is unhappy or angry with him. then they gave the explanation, the master is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the house is the Islam. Sorry, the house is the Jannah, the heaven. And the invitation or the food is the Islam. And the inviter is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, and here it was given as an example, like you have invitation, you have food put there, you know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants everyone to come. And by this, I may see some relation here between this and the name Ma'idah, even though the name Ma'idah was given to this surah because of that particular story we spoke about at the end of this surah. Okay, this question about the bigger and smaller surahs, thank you, you remind me, because I forgot to say that Surah An-Nisa, when it speaks about social matters, you are smaller than it, perhaps some, this may touch different subject and the other one may touch different subject. You have Surah An-Nur in the second portion, in the Mi'in, you have Surah Al-Ahzab with some similarity in the third portion, and you have Surah Al-Hujurat in Mufassal, or this is not in the Mufassal, as the smallest. Yani this one contains 29 pages, this one 10 pages, and this one again 10 pages, and this one 2.5 pages. And you see the size of them getting smaller, and you may anyone want to broaden his knowledge about social workers, about social relation, he should look at these different surahs. We may have others, you know, which did not come to my mind. Thank you for this question because this reminded me of what I forgot. You have a question here? For what reason? Again, I forgot to mention it, you know, I should mention why it was called the woman, woman surah. I imagine, I don't know, for sure at the beginning it's mentioned, you know, what the, وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. The word nisa was mentioned at the first verse, you know, of this surah. I feel if this universe is all, or this globe here, they are all males, you know, no relation is going to be, you know, we are tough here, you know, the males generally, they are tough, you know, and everyone will be by his own and has his life, you know, don't care about the other. I look at the other side, I ask, humidify, moisten the environment, you know, and be more soft and more delicate, you know, for this matter. Unfortunately, nowadays, they try to strengthen the woman and make her like tough like the man, you know, which I think is going to jeopardize the whole relation, you know, between the all humans, you know, and even it will interrupt the whole social relation, you know, between people, you know, if the woman became tough one. And here, as we mentioned before, you should have tough and soft, you know, to have it work. The toughness, it has its place, and the softness has its place. Generally speaking, you may have very soft man, and you may have very tough woman. But generally speaking, males, they tend to be tougher, you know. And the women, they tend to be more delicate and more softer. And this is, there's a wisdom behind it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we go over this wisdom, you know, and try to correct, we said correct or jeopardize it, you know, according to our look, this is going to be warning sign. Okay, yani here the title was given Nisa because really the women, they are the one who keep up the relation, humidify the environment all the time. You know. If this universe or this globe is only males, it's going to be tough, too tough, you know, and everyone will be sitting alone, you know, in one room or in his cave or whatever, you know. Usually the women, they are the one who try to make the men, you know, come and visit or go here or have relation with that person or you name it. This is my understanding. I may be right or perhaps some men, they don't like it. Perhaps some females, they don't like it, you know. They want to be like men, you know. I don't know. So this is the wisdom behind it, I think, in my opinion. That's why it was given this title, An-Nisa, because really they have significant role in this, you know, in the social relations. Other questions? Okay. So here for the role, for governmental issue, I said some of the punishment, you know, the fifth punishment is mentioned here, when anyone try to cut the road and try to make robberies, you know, against people outside the cities, what we call it qat' al-tariq in Arabic language, again they are mentioned here, besides many other governmental and issues. And in Surah Al-Nisa and Surah Al-Ma'idah, you find some verses speaking against the Jews and against the Christians. Here, you don't have it like we said about Baqarah and Imran. Baqarah, most of it against the Jews, and Ali Imran, most of it against the Christian. Here, you find certain verses, you know, speak about both sides, you know, in different way, when they fail to fulfill the orders of, or commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Nisa regarding their social relation, and in Surah Al-Ma'idah regarding their governmental or how to handle their state. Any question about Surah Al-Ma'idah? By this, we cover almost all quarters that we mentioned before. We mentioned the worship quarter, the marriage quarter, and the money contracts and deals quarter, and the governmental quarter. These are four quarters. It covers its Islam by its broad meaning. Okay, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the hadith Sayyidina Jibreel, al-Islam, in the summary, he pointed for five pillars which are of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the scholar, this is a summary. This is not all of Islam, because Islam, as we said, deal with four different quarters, and these four quarters have been covered well, very well in these four surahs. And when you finish this surah, you have the complete Islam apparent and manifested, you know, by these four surahs. When you match it to the life of the Prophet ﷺ, it will be shown very well how great was the state which was established by the Prophet ﷺ in Medina al-Munawwara. The exception is Sab'at Tiwal of being Madani. And all the surahs, the four surahs that he mentioned, and these surahs, they are Madani also. Al-Anfal wa Tawbah, besides the first four surahs, Baqarah, Ali Imran, Nisa, Al-Ma'idah, they are all of them Madani. The exception in the Sab'at Tiwal of Meccan surah, they are these two surahs, Al-An'am wa Al-A'raf. Usually it's unusual to have very long Mecki surah, okay? And these are the exception, and that's why these two surahs, they have been called At-Tulayan. And these are the two longest surah among the Makki. At-Tulayan. Surah Al-Baqarah is called At-Tula. This is the longest one, okay? The longest one of Al-Baqarah is called At-Tula. And these are the two longest one regarding the Makkian surahs. And one of them was mentioned, the hadith, as Tula At-Tulayn. This is the long among the two longest. Sayyidina Zayd ibn Thabit narrated that the Prophet ﷺ prayed Maghrib one time and he recited Tula Tulayn, Surah Al-A'raf. Try it one day, you know, when you are alone. Just for the Sunnah. Good one. Okay. The specialty about Surah Al-An'am as mentioned by Itqan and Imam Suyuti and other books that this was revealed completely. This is perhaps the longest ever revelation in the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The whole surah, this is 23 pages, it was revealed completely, not 5 by 5 as we said about most of the revelation of the Quran. Okay, it was revealed completely, joined by 70,000 angels. This is what mentioned in the hadith about Surah Al-An'am. What the meaning of Surah Al-An'am in general? As we said, when you fix your Islam by the first four surahs, this to fix your Iman, which is the second major component. And you just look at hadith Sayyidina Jibreel when he asked the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with different relations, firstly about Islam, then about Iman. You have the other relation, he asked firstly about Iman and secondly about Islam, and we explained the difference, you know, and how most of us, you know, they will go from Islam to Iman gradually. Some they may have it in opposite way, to have the Iman and then go and practice their Islam. Okay, so here, as you look at the first four surahs, you know, covering Islam in very detailed way, you look at Surah Al-An'am covering the Iman in very detailed way. That's why what we expect here, you expect to have speaking about the pillars of Iman, speaking about Allah, speaking about the angels, speaking about the books, speaking about the messengers and prophets, speaking about the hereafter, speaking about the destiny. See, out of surprise, in Aqidah book, even they speak about the signs of the hereafter. And we have some hint, you know, at the end page, you know, of this surah of speaking about the signs of the hereafter. Okay? يعني, I look at Surah Al-An'am as a book of Aqidah. I would rather say this is the best book to be read, you know, in Aqidah, Surah Al-An'am. Okay. What's unique about Surah Al-An'am? We said that Tawheed or Aqeedah, usually it has two components. It has the positive way and the negative way. How? When you say, La ilaha illallah, this sentence, it has negative side and positive side. La ilaha is the negative side. Illallah is the positive side. You have this famous verse, we use it all the time. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ is negative. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ, affirmative, to affirm something to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have the famous surah that we use it for aqidah. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ. لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. This is affirmative and this is negative. You have Ayatul Kursi again. You have each sentence in Ayatul Kursi. One is affirmative, the other one is negative. Okay. Here in this surah, the same pattern but in longer way. يعني you may have roughly one page, more or less, affirmative. Then you have one page negative, and you go by this pattern from the beginning till the end of the surah. What do I mean by negative here? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to speak about those who are unbelievers, non-believers, or those who lied on Allah. That's why the word kadhib has been repeatedly mentioned in this surah. Okay, why? Because many of these negative aspects is going to explain some lies or some liars who spoke ignorantly about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is basically about Surah Al-An'am. And this is, I remind everyone, this is one surah also start by Alhamdulillah. يعني here, as if you finish the first quarter, because they said each quarter of the Quran start by Alhamdulillah. The first quarter start by Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Surah Al-Fatiha. The second quarter start by this surah, Alhamdulillah Alladhi Khalaqa As-Samawati Wal-Ard. Each quarter, we have four quarters in the Quran, each quarter start by Alhamdulillah. But put in mind, this quarter, they are not equal to the four divisions that we mentioned before about As-Sab'a Tawal, Wal-Mi'un, Wal-Masa'a. Okay? Yeah, this is much more closer, even though it's not precise, but much more closer to the quarter in size, not in that division that we mentioned, you know, about As-Sab'a Tawal, Wal-Mi'un, Wal-Masa'a, Wal-Mufassal. Begin of the second quarter, you may call it. Any question about Surah Al-An'am? As you may see, sometimes we find it easy, sometimes I find it difficult, you know, to relate, to give the reason or whatever. Here, it's too easy to me because the last verse in Surah Al-An'am speak about خلائف or خلفاء, the same, but this is a plural form of خليفة, okay? Yeah, the last verse in Surah Al-An'am speak about خلائف, and this is, I feel it as an introduction to Surah Al-A'raf. That's why the word خلفاء is mentioned twice in Surah Al-A'raf, okay? Two times. And that's why Surah Al-A'raf speak about anyone or any community who fix the five surahs, you know, namely Islam and Iman, they are eligible to be Khalifa in this, on the earth. And they are going to be assigned from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why when Allah, in Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the famous nations, I cannot say all of them, mentioned the famous nation who were on the land and they were given the khilafah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how they disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they were banished, you know, by one way or another. So namely, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stopped here in Surah Al-A'raf by the most first khalifa, who is? Sayyidina Adam, in Surah Al-Baqarah, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. The story of Sayyidina Adam, the most first one, has been mentioned in three pages or so in Surah Al-A'raf. This is the first Khalifa. Then, the Surah did not go by orders, because if it goes by orders, the hereafter should be mentioned at the end. No, you have the hereafter, the detailed events of the hereafter mentioned right after Adam. Al-Yawm Al-Akhir. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala start to speak about Nuh, Hud, Salih, and his people, not alone. Lut, Shu'aib, Musa, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this nation and Islam. And you have the term here in Sayyidina Hud's story, وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ جَعَلَكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ بَعْدَ قَوْمِهُ. Reminded them, Sayyidina Hud, the Prophet Hud, reminded his people that they are khulafa after the people of Nuh. Okay? And again you have the same quotation in Sayyidina Salih, when he reminded his people, وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ جَعَلَكُمْ خُلَفَاءَ بَعْدَ عَادٍ. Okay, I'm not going to tell you it has been mentioned all the way. No, it was mentioned twice. As I said, khulafa, the word khulafa was mentioned twice. And this, then about Hud, Shu'aib. Then about Musa, this is one of the long detailed surah speak about Sayyidina Musa and how did he deal with his people. And many events even spoke about certain events happened after Sayyidina Musa. Then it gave a hint about the people of the Prophet ﷺ by the verse, وَمِمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا أُمَّةً. No, not by him. It was obvious when this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about our Prophet, الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّيَّ الَّذِي يَجِدُ. The description, this is one of the longest and detailed description about our Prophet mentioned in this verse. And وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِهِ وَاتَّبَعُوا, those followers of him, again they were mentioned in this particular surah. Okay? So basically, here, this surah as if it gives you how, who is, firstly, who is eligible to be Khalifa, represent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this earth, those who rule according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and give you a story about different types and different styles of khulafa till we reach our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our nation. The question we speak about the greatness of Surah Al-An'am, which was revealed completely with the 70s, and how we should deal with this, you know, for sure. Yani this, you have many factors, you know, that make you, we should highly respect, and we should be aware of this favor on Allah, from Allah on you, and the revelation of the Quran in different patterns. For example, this is one pattern that this has been revealed completely with 70,000. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made 70,000 angels, you know, busy for us, you know, to descend this surah. Okay, and the length, you know, from where did it come? It took 1,000 years to come from the. Wherever it came, you know, another this is, and here you may look at it time-wise, space-wise, or place-wise, angel-wise, and wisdom-wise, and from where did it come from, Allah, and you may have different aspects of, to drive you to respect this word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and for sure, as mentioned the question, this is one way of looking at how to respect the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have this problem, we got used, you know, to the Quran. Usually we don't have this high respect to it. Yani we should be much more respectful, you know, to the Quran and whatever related to it. Other questions? Yes?
Why was the Qawm Salih and the Qawm Salih, why would they refer to as Kulafa if they didn't?
For sure, because the Prophet ﷺ said this is the first messenger to the people of the earth. It's not going to say khulafa, okay? Because this was considered by one way or another khulafa, okay? Why it not mentioned after that? I think in Arabic and perhaps in other languages also, repetition, when you repeat a lot, you know, this make the statement or the text make it too weak, okay? And here you give hint, you give, and this is well known in the Quran in particular, you know. If the Quran is going to deal with these, all of these issues, you know, in detail, it's going to be larger than from this world to that world, you know. Okay, so by this greatness of having it in summary, you know, and give you a hint and speak about it here and you name it, this is make the Quran as a great one, you know, in its size and in its coverage. Okay, it covers everything, tibyana li kulli shay, which is not almost, it is impossible to be done by a human. Yes?
If they didn't believe, why were they considered qulafa? Because they didn't embrace those first.
Some of them, they believe, they have a prophet, they were the people who are khulafa, they were eligible to be khulafa, but they failed to do so. Other questions? Yes?
The first group of the Arab report, the three surahs that start with the letters from the Baqarah?
No, two of them. Next, yani I postponed it, but I'm going to highlight now some of it, you know. You have all surahs start by huruf like Alif Lam Ra or Hawamim or Tawasim. They are going to be after each other, okay? The exception is Alif Lam Mim. You have two surahs, they are Madani in this portion of the Quran. And you have in the third portion, in the Mathani, four of them who are Makkiyan surah, okay? Well, inshallah, if we have time, you know, or life to speak about this, we'll speak about it when we speak about the Makkah. يعني what I'm trying to say, this group is the only group among those groups who started by ahruf, by letters, which has been separated between the seven al-tiwal, the first two, and then you have four of them, you know, in the Masani, and again in the pattern, because you have two of them, they are Madani, and four of them, they are Makki. Other questions? Firstly, the question is about the revelation, how they sent, you know, to us. Firstly, for sure, it was in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The knowledge of Allah, this one attribute of Allah, there is no time, no date here, because this is eternally, eternally in the past, you know, no beginning of it, you know, as any attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot set up a time of the beginning of it. So here, the Quran was included in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or I would rather say again, one attribute of Allah, kalam, speech, the speech of Allah. Again, this is very old, ancient one, or we cannot say old perhaps, because it's older than the old. Then you have the first manifestation of it in the creation, as mentioned in the Quran, وَإِنَّهُ فِي أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ. This is the first manifestation in the creation. For sure, أُمِّ الْكِتَابِ is, according to many scholars, the tablet. اللوح المحفوظ, we call it, okay? The tablet and the pen, they are one of the first creation ever, okay? And this is the first area, or the first place to have the Quran manifested, you know, in the creation, was in the tablet. Then, in that year, this, what time did it happen? At the beginning of the creation. I cannot give you number here, okay? Then, in the year when the Prophet ﷺ received the revelation, namely when he was 40 years old, in the mid of Sha'ban, it's before Ramadan, in mid of Sha'ban, the Quran, all of it, some narration that all of it, the other narration that in every year, you have what is going to be revealed in this week. Yani, according to the other narration, you have 23 different descent, you know, of the Quran on yearly basis to a level. They call it al-wahid mahu al-isbat. You have other tablets which has a lot of erasing and confirm. Yeah, they will write down something, they erase something, you know. Example of it, when someone commits sin, you know, this is going to be written in these tablets, and when he makes tawbah, this may be erased. Yeah, this is the, by this simple way I may imagine it, okay? So here you have a level called Al-Wahid Mahu Al-Isbat. The Prophet ﷺ, during his Mi'raj, he said, I was ascended to a level, I hear the erasing, or hear the writing of the pens. For sure, this is not the first pen which wrote everything, you know, and stopped millions, I don't know how many years, you know, ago, okay? Because physically, the Prophet ﷺ heard the writing, the voice of the writing of certain pens, which is of that level. And according to some scholars, this level is around the kursi. You see, al-kursi, that chair, which mentioned, you know, an ayat al-kursi, this is the level which was descended. So here you have, let's say, one of 23rd of the Quran was sent down on the mid of Sha'ban of the year of revelation. Then you have the whole Quran went down to the first heaven. To a place called the house of Anar, the house of Anar, Bayt al-Izzah. Okay? And in the same, this in the night of Laylat al-Qadr, and in the same night, the first five verses of Surah Iqra, they went all the way down to Ghar Hira. Very long trip. How long is it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about all of our action, you know, it takes 1,000 years. It takes 1,000 years. And anything, I see, you have the shortest revelation, you have غَيْرُ إِلِ الضَّرَرِ, three words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala get many creations, you know, involved in it, we don't know their number, and it took these three words, you know, it took the journey of 1,000 years to come all the way down. Why? To make it available for us. تفضل. Okay? To make it available for us. How we are going to respond to this? Other questions? Yes? Number 23, because this, the Prophet ﷺ lived after revelation 10 years in Mecca and 13 years in Mecca and 10 years in Medina. Maybe, I don't know. I cannot answer the question, but this number came from the years of the Prophet ﷺ after I don't know if you have some hikmah in this regard, I may not know it. There's two narration here. We have one narration that the whole Quran descended from Umm al-Kitab to Al-Wahi Mahu al-Isbat completely. Because what's make it stronger that you have it all the way also to the house of honor, you know, in the first heaven. Okay. The other narration, as you know, in mid of Sha'ban every year, everything which was going to happen in this particular year is going to go from the tablet to Al-Wahid Mahawul Isbat in that particular night. Okay. So according to this, yani one sound more reasonable because it said that the portion of the Quran which is going to be revealed over this year was descended only, and the other one said no, all of the Quran, because all of the Quran reached the first heaven, you know, at that particular year, in Laylat al Qadr. Other question? Yes, I make it a little bit more complicated, sorry. Yes.
Could you just write the name of the tablet?
Al-Lawh al-Mahfuz.
The ones below it.
Yeah, this is mentioned in Surah Al-Buruj. Inna Qur'an al-Majid fi lawh al-Mahfuz. Many scholars, they said they are vocabulary, this. Umm al-Kitab and Lawh al-Mahfuz, the same thing.
Sorry, the ones below
it,
the ones that are
called. Yes, Al-Wahid Mahwa Al-Isbat. From where we did get this word? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Ra'd, يَمْحُوا اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثْبِتْ وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. Yani gave a hint about those tablets that anything may be erased there or confirmed. وَعِنْدَهُ belongs to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. The original one, the original copy, that there's no erasing, no confirmation. That's why in some ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, جَفَّ الْقَلَمِ. You see, in the old days when you have an ink, you know, and you want to write, if you try to make this before it's dried, you know, when it's humid, you know, it's going to mess up, you know, the whole page, you know. جَفَّ الْقَلَمْ, that's mean, يعني, everything was written there in the tablets, and no adding, no humidity, and it's dried completely, you know. Whereas those tablets, according to the Prophet ﷺ, every time you may have something written down or erased, continuously. Other questions? Yes? No. Bayt al-Izzah is different than Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur. Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur, according to many scholars, is in the seventh heaven. Whereas Bayt al-Izzah, this house of some specialty, I don't know what specialty is it, you know, and this is in the first heaven, not in the seventh heaven. No, this is different. The question was, this is the Bayt Azza, they make tawaf, the angel make tawaf around it. No, this is completely different. Al-Bayt al-Ma'mur is different than Bayt al-Azza. We have a lot of rooms or a lot of houses, you know, in the heavens, you know. They are not empty.
So the angels make tawaf around Bayt al-Ma'mur. And they're
yes.
All on top of the Kaaba, directly?
Yes. What the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in his hadith, 70,000 per day of the angels, they make tawaf around Bayt al-Ma'mur. They will not have the chance to repeat this tawaf till the hereafter. No another term, you know, because you have a huge number, you know, of angels, you know. You have 70,000 perform this tawaf every day, but they don't have the chance to repeat the tawaf till the hereafter because of the huge number. They will not have the second turn. Yes?
Is the
justification
for the humankind written in these tablets?
For the tablet, the original one, as the Prophet ﷺ specified, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the pen to write down all knowledge of Allah till the hereafter. For sure, your question is included there, you know, the human, all humankind, and you name it. In these tablets, I don't know exactly, you know, what's going on, but I imagine, you know, in the collection of all of them, yes, all of us are written there, you know. But who belong to what tablet, I don't know. Yes?
Yeah, how does this square up when you say that Allah's got infinite knowledge? You can't limit the knowledge of Allah, so when you say it's all written?
Not all. I did not say all. I said His knowledge in His creation till the hereafter. Yeah, it's too limited. Firstly, the knowledge of Allah not limited to His creation. Secondly, this till the hereafter, yani this for limited period of time. Even though we may feel it's too long, you know, but for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's too short. Okay. So here, we did not say that. I think to say so is against the Quran, because the Quran said that even if you have the largest amount, you know, of pens, you know, and largest amount of ink, is not going to write the knowledge of Allah. No, nothing can contain the knowledge of Allah at all. Since the tablet is a creation, for sure we believe that it's not going to contain the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But for sure this tablet is huge in its knowledge, because it contains the knowledge about the creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the hereafter. And in to make it more clear for us, in Bukhari, Sayyidina al-Khadr told Sayyidina Musa, you see my knowledge to your knowledge, to the knowledge of all creation, did not take of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except what this bird took from the ocean. And the bird will drink how much, one drop or two drops, you know, is going to be taken. And here, if you believe that the tablet, and you should believe that this tablet is a creation, that means you gather whatever in this tablet to all, everything that we know, all those matters and everything did not take from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except like one drop. Don't tell me what's left, you know, because I don't know what's left. Okay? And this, I heard this from some people or some silly people. What's left? I don't know. I don't know what's left, you know, because this is the knowledge of Allah. If I know it, I'm not human by this. Okay. Yes?
Is the date of the Bakhra or the Yom Kiyamah written in the Quran?
Date of?
Of Yom Kiyamah. Is it mentioned in the Quran?
I cannot be definite about it, but I think most probably yes. Because this part of the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His creation till the hereafter. But I cannot be 100% sure, but in high probability, yes, it's mentioned.
When you said the middle of Sha'ban, which revelation we said when the narration happened in the middle of Sha'ban?
This is in the second surah, thank you for this. In the first surah, Surah Al-Zukhruf, حاميم الزخرف الله سبحانه وتعالى mention وإنه في أم الكتاب. In the second surah, يعني this is the first surah, I don't know what chapter. حاميم والكتاب المبين إن جعلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون وإنه في أم الكتاب. Okay, the second surah after it, right after it. حاميم والكتاب المبين إنا أنزلناه في ليلة مباركة إنا كنا منذرين فيها يفرق كل أمر حكيم. Why did I say كرسي? Because I read for some scholars, they said at the كرسي the differentiation is going to be there. Here Allah سبحانه وتعالى said فيها يفرق. Okay, يعني you have the differentiation. And that's why when our friends ask us about our written name here, you know, here you have differentiation, you have different tablets, you know. I don't know in what tablet my name is written. Okay. Other questions? I mean, they went outside the subject, you know, and us. No more questions? Okay. Any question about Surah Al-A'raf?
The meaning of
A'raf?
The connection.
A'raf is mentioned in this Surah and only in this Surah, never mentioned elsewhere. They have controversy about interpreting it, but in my mind, the most obvious one, that it's an intermediate position between hellfire and heaven. And this, if I'm right, I don't know how right I am, you know, if this is the case, even those khulafa, they are intermediate. Yani they are going to have someone before, predecessor, and some who come after, successor, okay? It's not something firm or something to last forever. It's an intermediate phase or position. Yes?
Did you say that when you were saying about the story of the person that's taken from hellfire to heaven, as he keeps making requests to Allah, did you say when in the middle that's the same case?
No. When the all human gather for the hereafter, the rule is given that anyone who his hasanat, the good deeds, more than his bad deeds or sayyiat, he will go to heaven right away after perhaps hisab or without hisab. We don't know. Okay, we have the two possibilities: either without hisab for some, or with hisab for many. Then, the one who his bad deeds, sayyat, are more than his hasanat, he is eligible to go to hellfire. Not all of them they are going to go. Some of them, or many, I don't know, nas'al Allah salama, some of them they will go. The other of them, Allah forgives them. The third part, they have intercession from some prophets or angels or righteous people not to go to hellfire. Okay? Yani, as a rule, they deserve all of them to go to hellfire, but not all of them they are going to go. Okay? Whereas the first item, all of them they will go to hell after hisab or before. We have third part who their hasanat and sayyat, they are equal. Okay? Yani, this may be rare, but you have some number here, you know, especially when you have billions of people, you know, for sure you are going to find few of them, they have equal number, you know, of their hasanat and their sayyat. And these people that are going to stuck in A'raf for a while, as mentioned in this surah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of His mercy send them to Him. And some scholars, they said, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests to His people subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter, and everyone performs sujood, this sujood is going to be counted for these people to have one hasana more, you know, and let them go to Him. Allah is merciful. Okay. Other questions? Move to Surah Al-Anfal quickly. Whenever you have Khilafah, what's the expectation? We are going to have fighting between the people of Allah and people of devil. Okay, this devil, he gave a commitment to Allah that is going to take his people away till hereafter. Okay, and for sure he's going to stimulate many persons, you know, to fight these people who are well established, you know, by their Islam, by their Iman, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them Khalifa. So here you expect to have fighting, and this was the first fighting ever in the, not the first, the first famous fighting, you know, in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was not the first, very first one, but this is the first famous one which has significant turn point in the life, yani in the life of Islam, let's say, okay? And this is one of the significant turn point in the story or the history of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his people, and for sure his story is the story of the whole Islam. So here, this surah in particular speak about the first famous fighting which has a significant turn point in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we want to put it by date, should be between Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran. Okay? Should be between Surah Al-Baqarah, because the date, and I think in some narration it was revealed as such, you know, after Surah Al-Baqarah. Okay, because if you remember, we put the date that Surah Al-Baqarah told before Badr and Surah Ali Imran after Badr. Okay, this gap should be filled by Surah Al-Anfal. Why it was moved here? Because as you may know, we should fix all of these matters, you know, before having this event. And this has been fixed very well, you know, by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion in the Meccan and the first Madani phase, you know, before having Surah, before having this fight. The holy names, yani here again, the one who want to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more, he should try to match the subject and whatever he understand of this surah with the name which has been repeatedly mentioned, you know, in the surah. And here, I cannot figure out for all surahs, you know, the name, yani, I did not find, you know, repeatedly one name or two names mentioned, you know, but for sure it's quite obvious in Surah An-Nisa, as you mentioned, Alim and Hakima, and here in Surah Al-Anfal, you have Sami'un Alim. As two names, they have been mentioned, I think, five or six times. Any question? Shall we stop here or let's, do you have time to finish, you know, this first portion? Okay, we'll finish it quickly, you know. This Surah Al-Tawbah, this is according to the chronology or the time-wise, this is one of the latest surah to be revealed as a long surah, and this reflects the last portion of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you expect whenever you have significant victory as happened to the Muslimin in Ghazwat Badr, what's the outcome after it? Hypocrisy is going to be much more, okay? Whenever you have strong person next to him, you are going to have a weak one, hypocritic, okay? That's why the main subject of Surah At-Tawbah to speak about hypocrisy and hypocrites. Any question? Yes?
Why does this surah start without Bismillah?
Why Surah At-Tawbah? This is the exceptional one from the whole Quran. Yani, as you may know, all surahs of the Quran is written in the book Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim at the beginning of it, except this surah. We have three different opinions. The first opinion, and this goes much with the Hanafi opinion, that as Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, when he was asked, how come you added Surah At-Tawbah to Surah Al-Anfal and you put with him in the Sab'a al-Tiwal, without Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever he has revelation, he will instruct us to put this in that particular place. He passed away before telling us that this surah belonged to the other surah or does not belong. I thought they are similar, you know, they have a lot of similarity. So that's why they were joined and without Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is goes more by the Hanafi. Why? Because the Hanafi, they said, no problem, even if you said Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, no sin here. Okay? And this goes by this opinion, you know, opinion of Sayyidina Uthman, that the joint between the two surahs. The opinion of Sayyidina Ali goes more with the Shafi'i opinion. He said, because in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you have the word mercy, most merciful and most passionate or whatever. And the word mercy has been mentioned twice in Arabic, and this contradicts with the beginning of this particular surah, because there's a lot of warning, and this, according to some companion called the surah of adab, punishment, or fadiha, to uncover those who try to cover it. You see, yani here, according to Sayyidina Ali's opinion, that this is, that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is against the beginning of this surah. Okay? The third opinion, perhaps goes by the Maliki opinion, that, and I think Imam Malik has this answer, that the first portion of Surah At-Tawbah was abrogated, and with it, the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim was abrogated, you know, from the beginning. Okay? As if you have the beginning of that surah taken away, abrogate only this, going to happen during the time of the Prophet. No one has the right to have any abrogation of the Quran except what the order comes by. Okay, so the third opinion, it's because of abrogation. The beginning of this surah was abrogated, and Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim was abrogated. Just I remind you and everyone, even though Surah Tawbah doesn't have Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, but it starts by the letter B, Bara'ah. Okay? Bismillah, or in surah start with ba, and here you have ba also, bara'atu min Allah wa rasul. Any other question? Okay. No. The hypocrites, they have been available all the time. Okay, but this is as an outcome of what happened here. Whenever you are given victory, you expect to have much more hypocrites, you know, around you. Okay, so this you take it by the order, and this happened during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When he came to Medina al-Munawwara, we have four different type of people. You have the Muslim, you have the non-believer infidels, you have people of book, and you have hypocrites. When battle of Badr took place, one of these vanished, which is the infidels. You don't have infidels anymore. Some of them, they became Muslim, real Muslim. The other, they became hypocritic. And you have one of these four types taken away after the Zulfiqar. Yes?
Just regarding Bismillah, with Al-Fatiha, some Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is actually the first ayat of Al-Fatiha. Some, they put Bismillah as the other surahs are, and the first ayat is Alhamdulillah, which is correct.
Both of them correct. Why? Because, as you may know, Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan sent different copies of the Mus'haf. One Madani, one Makki, one Syrian, one Kufiyan, one Basri, okay? So, in these masahif, you have Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim as the first verse in the Kufi and the Makkiyan one. And you don't have it as such in the Madani and Syrian and Basri one. Okay? So both of them, they are correct. Oh, yeah. Other questions? Yes? The question is, the hypocrites, they will go to hellfire. The first and initial answer would be not only hellfire, the worst position, you know, the hellfire. But here, yani out of our hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hypocrisy is very broad word, okay. So if I think if it's related to his belief, for sure he's going to go to hellfire. But if it's for action or something of that regard, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive him. Yes? Was the Bismillah repeated as a verse? Yeah, what do you mean by this question? I understood the wording, but I did not understand what do you mean by this question. This is not by 5 by 5, no. At the beginning of each surah. Yani in one narration that they know the beginning of the surah by Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Other questions? Yes? Repeat it again, please. Yeah, what I said about the two holy names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are going to find some of the surahs in the Quran. According to me, I may be wrong, you know, perhaps all surahs. But some of the surahs, obviously you are going to find a repetition of two names or one names or whatever. To be honest with you, I'm poor, you know, in knowing the relation between these names, you know, and the common subject of this surah. But I encourage everyone to find out, you know, what's the relation between this repetition, you know, of mentioning these names and the common subject of the surah. That's what I'll say. Does this clarify your question?
It does, kind of. But what were the two names that you mentioned for Surah Al-Anfal?
Sami'un Ali. Sami'un Ali. Other questions? No more questions? Inshallah, we'll stop here, you know. Alhamdulillah, inshallah, we'll finish the Sab'a al-Tiwal in not well-oriented way.